Welcome, everyone, to the ICA. My name's Gregor Muir. I'm the director of the ICA. It's really good to see you all. I know for many people this week is a busy one, and I'm especially pleased to welcome our panel to talk about London squats and counterculture, 1970s to now. Welcome to the evening's chair, writer and artist Neal Brown, just to my right, and also delighted to welcome Viv Albertine on the far end there, Route Blees, Luxemburg, Peter Doig in red, and Jimmy Cauty. Of course, the starting point for the panel is the Smiler exhibition downstairs in our reading room, which is the technical word for the room under the bar, which is featuring remarkable photographs by Mark Cawson. The show's been curated by Gareth McConnell alongside ICA curator Matt Williams. To mark the occasion of this show, Sorika have published the book Smiler by Mark Cawson and Neal Brown, which we're delighted to launch here tonight. Copies are available to buy outside and downstairs in the bookshop. We have about 1 hour ahead of us, I hope, of conversation, and there'll be the opportunity for questions to be asked at the end. Please hold up your hand and a mic will come to you. I'd also just remind all of us, including myself, to turn our phones off if we could. That would be really, really great. Afterwards, please join us downstairs in the bar for the exhibition opening party with DJs Bahami and Moore, Ivan Smaggy, and Nathan Gregory Wilkins, who will be playing until 1 a.m. So you're really booked in for a long evening here, I think. Before handing over to our panel, I'd like to offer a huge thanks and congratulations to Mark Cawson for creating this incredible body of work. To Neal, yeah, Mark, well done. A beautiful, beautiful photographs. Also, thanks to Neal for steering this evening and writing Camera Squat Art Smiler, an extract from which you'll find on your seats. And the full version is featured in the book. And to also Gareth and Matt, thank you very much for working on the show and producing this brilliant publication. So without any more from me, could we give our panel a round of applause? Thank you very, very much.
Good evening. Welcome. It's very kind of the ICA to give us room to fail. We're going to fail to cover Smiler's work, squatting, housing problems, creativity. We're going to fail, but hopefully we'll fail magnificently. In the context of that failure, I will, as a precaution, this talk is being videoed and will be on YouTube. I'd like to imagine that present here, not just these talented creative people, but also maybe between Pete and Jimmy, a homeless person that's, or someone who has suffering difficulties related to that. I just want to put it in that context that we don't forget that, or that I don't forget that. So we're not going to do justice to all the possible themes that we're going to try. I'm going to drop Route Blees Luxemburg in the deep end. Route is a reader of urban aesthetics at the RCA, and Route doesn't know Smiler, and she hasn't been a squatter. Everyone else here has been a squatter, and that qualifies her to give an objective, unbiased opinion on Smiler's work. So perhaps we could start there with you, Ruth.
Thank you. Good evening. So when I look at these photographs, we obviously see them as records, records of a certain time in London, which is long gone. But I think these images are more than records. For me, they make visible that what is usually invisible in our culture, that which falls outside the norm or outside the status quo. And I think the artist has managed to capture that, and that's why these images still resonate. And why is it important to show that which is sort of disruptive or maybe even agonizing to us, to society, to the viewer? Well, I think that's perhaps the power of photography, because it is a tool which can provoke us to think about it, but also to think about the future and possibility. So that's how I read his photographs, not as a record, this is past, this is nostalgic. No, this is something that captures a moment, but that moment is still ongoing, but maybe it's now more invisible. And maybe it's also a challenge to us to think about making visible that kind of resistance again, because the resistance, I think, is clearly still here in London.
Thanks, Ruth. Viv, you... I've read your book recently and enjoyed it very much. It's really fantastic. There's a lot of crossover between the geography, the activities, the music you describe, and Smiler's work. How do you feel when you see it?
I think it reminds me that we had a space back, you know, I started squatting about 75, 76, broke into a house in Shepherd's Bush. And from then on, almost everyone I knew lived in squats, and you'd often meet people and rehearse, etc. And it just reminds me of, because I wasn't really part of a very seedy side of squatting. It wasn't always organised, it wasn't always communal and that kind of thing. I mean, you know, some of us would just go out and break into an empty house we'd heard about. I wasn't ever part of a whole commune type thing. But it just reminds me of the space we had to sort of play around with life then, much as we were very much ignored, you know, as working class, not particularly well-educated, comprehensive school, which I sort of mucked up, dropped out of art school. I had sort of no role models, no paradigms to follow, really. And I just look back and think, I didn't really realise it, but we were playing with life. And I think there's something that's slightly missing now. It's so rigorous, you know, what young people are what's expected of young people. You know, get your A stars, get your degree, maybe a master's, you know, put a deposit down by the time you're 27. And I never thought of owning a home, you know. I even renting was beyond me. I never even thought of a job. But within that space, within that sort of lack of, I don't know, lack of validation, really, became this crack opened up where we could play, and this crack opened up where you actually didn't need to be able to be a virtuoso at anything. I just saw this little crack open up, really, you know, and it's partly through the housing, partly through punk music, and suddenly you could exist sort of off-grid in a way and make a whole alternative pattern for yourself, whole alternative life. Didn't know where it was going, didn't expect to ever own a place, didn't expect to ever have a job. It was really living day by day and making the most of each day.
Thanks, Viv. Pete, what about you?
In regards to?
When you see Smiler's work, what do you think? You knew Smiler in the olden days?
Well, first of all, I was very, very pleased that the photos still exist. And I actually remember quite a few of them from the time he took them. I met Smiler, I think, just after he graduated, or I don't know if he graduated, but when he left Hornsey College of Art. And I was just starting at St. Martin's. And he actually had quite a sort of, I think, conceptual approach to art making. He wasn't particularly into painting, and I was sort of coming here I wanted to be a painter. And so I think in the context of what he was doing then, and the fact that he's presented these photographs in a particular way as well. They're very selected, I guess, from probably a lot more photographs. I don't know. I think it's a great thing, an interesting thing.
I think at this point we should credit Gareth McConnell with his support of Smiler and his repair energy to help Smiler recover the integrity of the photographs from decades of quite a hard existence. Thank you, Gareth. Jimmy, you knew Smiler in the olden days. You squatted. What do you feel?
Yeah,
when you...
I did know Smiler, but I'm not sure how I know Smiler. And also, looking at those photos, I recognise quite a few people, but I don't remember who they are.
You didn't go out with any of them?
I did go out with one of them, actually. But over the years, you kind of forget that you knew so many people back in those days. So it's like a bit of a time warp, really, seeing those. And it reminds me of those days.
Okay, those days. There's a new publication out. There's an artist's work I like, Nathan Coley. He's got a publication that came out this year. I'm not going to explain what he does or anything. I'm just going to read the press release. It's about Frestonia, which some of you will know about, mm-hmm. big squatting area on the west side of Ladbroke Grove. But that's not the point. I'm going to read the press release. The residents of Frestonia developed a strong social fabric and complex cultural life before it fell into decline due to the crime, drugs, and social problems that gradually infiltrated the community. Some have struggled to write that, to cover the territory, to be fair, to honour them, but also to cover the hideous stuff that went on. The total range of depravity and creativity. So on the subject of depravity and creativity and squatting, would anyone like to say anything? Shall I decide who's the most creative and depraved and ask them directly? Squatting, the space you talked about opening up, Viv, allow people to rehearse and to make big canvases and make a mess, but it also allowed a whole group of disadvantaged people, which is good and right that disadvantaged people should participate, but it also brought them into a new relationship with, certainly gave them a new economic empowerment that they could be housed and money released to buy drugs. I'm taking quite a long time to getting round to asking everybody what they regard as the best and the worst of squatting.
Well, you know, it's funny you saying depraved, because actually I don't think we, you know, when I came to write my book, I thought, oh my God, there's no dirt, you know, it, compared to today, that it's all a bit tame. You know, it was such a slow life, because yes, we had, you know, say Joe Strummer's squat in Orsett Terrace, Joe Strummer, the 101ers, you know, Westbourne Grove, it all sounds so glamorous, but, and he said, oh, you know, if you want to form a band, you can rehearse here. But to get a band to rehearse, you know, I had to go all the way over to Sid Vicious's squat in Hampstead, and that would take a day, you know, an hour waiting for a bus, then change buses, then another bus, slowly get across London, sit upstairs hoping the conductor can't be bothered to come up, so you get away with not paying the fare, which happened nearly every time. They just couldn't be bothered to go upstairs. And, you know, get there, of course, no one's in, you wait around a couple of hours, go back again, eventually put a note through the door, rehearsal on Friday at Joe's. That would be one day taken up. The next day, you'd go to the bass player's house, you know, another 3 hours, this time to Shepherd's Bush or somewhere. So, you know, and so what's interesting, I just think what slow-paced lives we lived compared to today. No one even had landlines, you know, let alone mobiles. You couldn't call anybody. We had a phone box at the end of the road. So, you know, that'd be 4 or 5 days just spent trying to get people to come to a rehearsal, and you wouldn't even know if they'd turn up. They actually did turn up usually, because we all had nothing else to do. not on time or anything, but we rehearsed the whole of the summer of 76, the hottest summer on record, I think, still. It's quite funny to think we came out there, you know, completely, absolutely white as sheets, because we hadn't seen any of the summer, and without one song written or could play all the way through. But that's after a whole summer of rehearsing. But it's just interesting compared to today, when people are so scared that, you know, if you haven't put a deposit on a house by the time you're 27, or, you know, you haven't got a pop-up or a start-up or this or that happening in your 20s. You know, I even know of young people who just give up on life because they don't have that in their 20s, and friends are making it and they're not making it. And yet, you know, time is so elastic, really. We did these things so slowly, going from squat to squat, trying to find, you know, even just for something to do. Sometimes you get 3 buses across London to see if someone's in. And still, and yet, we made something that's still resonating so strongly 40 years later. So I just think there's such a lesson there in pace of life. You know, you don't need to hurtle through your 20s, or you can still make something that's so strong and so deep in slow time, in slow motion somehow. I don't know if that sort of says, it doesn't answer the depraved thing, because we were actually probably quite, I don't know, quite sort of driven in our own little way, but without the speed that happens now. And yet this thing that we did is so enthralling to young people who do have that speed now. And I don't really know why it does resonate so much later. We didn't expect it to, but I often compare that because I'm a rusher and a hustler, and it's quite interesting that you don't need to rush and hustle. You've got years, you know.
Thanks, Viv. I mean, the word depravity, maybe I should replace it with extremity. I mean, we see in the photographs people lying down in great distress off the edge of the map in terms of oblivion, disarray. That is...
Well, I think that when Smiler and I lived in the same neck of the woods, it was just off Cromer Street in King's Cross. I mean, I lived in King's Cross in squatted housing community for 17 years, all within about sort of 200 metres of the station. King's Cross changed dramatically when the Yorkshire Ripper came into play, because all the prostitutes came down north from the north because they were scared that he might get them. And so King's Cross became a sort of a kind of den of pimps and prostitutes and obviously drugs as well. And I think half the homes or spaces in our buildings were occupied by those people as well. So it was quite dangerous, really, I think. And so I think you always had to sort of watch yourself, really. And I think, you know, the spaces that, yes, that you could use, like we had a studio that we had for 14 years as a free space, but you know, you're always nervous it was going to get broken into, which it did do. People would just kick the door down, and you know, it was great to have that free space, of course, but you know, it was kind of at a cost, but exciting.
Yeah. Jimmy, what about you? What was your squat like? A nice, sensible, tidy squat?
It was quite sensible from time to time. But, you know, I squatted from 1977 until 1991. I think one of the things that I kind of remember about it is the ability to be able to experiment with other people's buildings. Usually, that would take the form of knocking walls down and having everything propped up with acro props was kind of the aesthetic that I was into at the time. And one house in Clapham that we had, we took the walls out and then we took all the floors out as well.
I heard about that. There's a party with no floorboards and people were...
Yeah, well, it wasn't really a party. It was just an ongoing thing. And so we ended up with just a room about the size of this room, and we would like build little platforms out of scaffolding to sleep on. But eventually, because we didn't really know, well, I didn't know anything about structural engineering, and yeah, the outside walls started to bow out eventually. So, you know, we did leave a bit of a trail of destroyed buildings, but only, you know, we were just experimenting, trying to find new ways of living.
New ways of living is a very nice way of putting it, Jimmy. Yeah.
Well, destroying buildings is another way of putting it, I guess.
There's some quotes in, there's a quote in Viv's book. We make an absolute racket in the flat. We play music all day and night. The scariest looking people come and go at all hours. And in Jimmy's book, I put a studio in the basement. Vice website. Yeah. I put a studio in the basement. Well, correct me if you didn't say it, because maybe they made it up. What they say you said that you may not have said is, I put a studio in the basement. I don't know how I got away with it. The poor neighbours. I mean, now I feel really sorry for them. But at the time, it didn't bother me.
That's just an age thing, isn't it? You know, when you're young, you don't really. It doesn't occur to you that people might be trying to sleep next door. You're just interested in what you're doing at the time. But that studio was built with money from Lambeth Council, actually, because we ended up, a lot of people where we were had to join housing co-ops as a way of staying in the buildings, because the council were trying to tighten up the whole thing, and we were in a self-help co-op, North Lambeth Housing Co-op, and the idea was that the council would give us money. They actually put money into my personal bank account to do up the building that I was in. So obviously, you know, my feeling was that I would do my best.
Obviously, they deserve royalties.
Yeah, there is an argument for that. So, it was weird that they'd want to do that, I thought, at the time. Because none of us really knew how to do proper building work. They'd just throw a bit of money at us and say, let's go and buy some sort of building materials and do some stuff to the house.
It was interesting. In my squat, which became a housing association, we were supported by the Tories for being entrepreneurial and enterprising, and by Labour for being community-minded and having social commitments. So we were double winners. It's interesting the way people chose to support or not support squatting. I'm going to ask Ruth a question in a minute. I just want to point out that three of the slides here that were chosen by me depict a tree. The tree, one picture is of the tree in its square of earth. The other one is of another tree nearby in a square of earth that someone has dumped some old plasterboard on. Another tree is one where someone has created a little garden. You see it coming up and going away. For me, being very literal-minded and didactic, that's a perfect summary of squatting. A piece of unused something that you can either crap on or you can take and deal with in creative and imaginative way. Ruth, can I ask you a funny question about you are a reader in urban aesthetics. Do you have an opinion on squat aesthetics?
Do I have a squatter aesthetic? That's kind of interesting, because what is a squatter aesthetic? And that makes me think, how does squatting affect your creativity? I mean, you're all squatters. How has it affected your creative output? And it's not just an economical question, being able to not have to hustle to earn the money to make a living, but how did that experience affect your creativity?
I am getting a little tired of asking questions, and you can now ask the three squatters.
Well, I am asking them. I mean, Pete, do you have something to say about that?
I think at one point, yes, my living situation was reflected in my work. But I kind of moved away from that purposefully.
Sure, yeah.
I wanted to kind of, because, I just didn't really feel like doing that anymore.
So you see a very clear relationship between your early output and living in
yeah, but
King's
I wasn't
Cross?
Really, I wasn't painting where I was, but I was painting places that were, and for things that were reflected in the music I was listening to.
Mm. What music were you listening to, Pete?
Lots of different music. I mean, yeah, lots of different.
Doesn't it all come together? You're in a squat, you're listening to the Clash, the Sex Pistols.
That's a bit of a cliche.
Well, correct me if I'm wrong, but you were there's a whole constellation of things that came together.
Well, I came to London in 1970, late 78, and I think that by 1980, people had kind of moved away from listening to punk music. I mean, at least I think suddenly there's this whole sort of influx of music coming from America. Like, I'd say hip-hop became a massive, massive thing in London. I mean, in the clubs that, and disco as well, kind of replaced, even though the clubs were still clubs that, the clubs to go to, the music changed.
Well, thinking about the squatter aesthetic, is it perhaps the aesthetic of the marginal, of the outsider? Of not
lawless,
really belonging.
Lawlessness. I can't say it.
Lawlessness.
Thank you. Yeah.
Yeah. I think I. You know, if I sort of dredge down into my brain and try and remember that far back, I mean, I learned to play in a squat. I learned to play guitar. Now I had no role models, no girls that played electric guitar that I could look to or wanted to be like. No internet, obviously, to search them out if there were any. And I used to sit there, and my friend Keith Levine, who was later, he's up there somewhere, who later was in Pill and Clash, he'd come around every day and say, oh, I'm not going to teach you chords, I'm going to teach you or talk to you about expressing yourself through the instrument. I mean, it was such a sort of conceptual way of coming at the guitar. And then he'd say, well, what do you want to sound like? And all I could think of were things around me. So I would say, oh, well, I want to sound like, machines or mosquitoes or... I want it to feel, really like a horrible, annoying noise, because that's what the space we sort of occupied in society. I mean, I felt like there were only about 50 people in London who were like us, and that, you know, us 50 people were hated, and it was a very, very violent time. I mean, not only did you expect your door to be not kicked down any time, I mean, us girls especially couldn't even walk the streets safely in the 70s. So much as, you know, it's very important not to mythologize those times as being something wonderful, because they were equally hard. I mean, we had to go around in groups of four at least everywhere and stay each night on someone else's floor because it was so very dangerous, because we weren't looking like normal girls and normal women. So anyway, yes, yeah, so I was learning guitar, or trying to find a way to play guitar and express my environment through sound, which I'd never done before, never been trained to do anything like that before. Didn't consider myself worthy, or it being, you know, being someone who was allowed to do that almost. That was for people who learnt violin at school, or, you know, there's no popular music taught in school in those days. So, yeah, to try and find the sounds through an electric instrument, I looked to sounds around me, because I didn't want to play 12-bar blues like the boys did. I wanted to play something completely different and outside that, rhythmically, tonally, and everything. So I tried to make a sound out of nothing. I still can't play chords now.
So sorry, I'm taking over here, Neil. So the squad isn't a gendered place as such.
You're the best person to answer that, Viv. Oh. You talked about opening squats up, and you talked about having no role models. Yeah. What female squat opening role models?
Yeah, no, I suppose there weren't any female squat opening role models. but the thing is, I, you know, interesting looking at Smiler's photographs, because I wasn't part of a scene like that, you know, and it wasn't a depraved, you know, people dying of heroin situation that I was in. You know, lots of the kids took speed, we ate Wimpies.
I might very respectfully interrupt you there, Viv. I think I've read your book more recently than you have, and in my opinion, there is a lot of depravity there. My mum would be really shocked if she read Viv's book. There's a lot of extremity there, Viv. I really think there is.
There's normal stuff. There's shitting and pissing and being sick, but there's nothing actually outside that really much, I think.
A lot of sexual abuse, a lot of intravenous drug use, there's a lot of violence. No?
Once or twice. It's about, everything's done about twice in my life, and it's in the book. I think do things twice and then stop. That's my motto. Yeah, you get away with it. Yeah, so, no, but, you know, it's a very different scene to what I can see in Smiler's photos. You know, individual squats, two little old ladies living downstairs, breaking one night, they're quaking, you know. We were polite, but insensitive, as Jimmy says, you know, to sound-wise. And then we'd get a taxi home to the next street, because there was an alley between the two roads, and then we'd all jump out and do a runner into our street, and then taxi drivers would lob bricks through our window. I mean, it was like living in Dodge City at the time. We lived on the edge. We weren't considered important. We didn't act like we were important. And we got up to mischief all the time, which turned out all right in the end. And I, yeah, definitely advocate it.
Jimmy, squat aesthetic?
Well, squat aesthetic, yeah, like I said, acro props and skips really were where I was coming from. But in terms of music and making music and being creative in a squat, I think that if you're like driven to do your thing, it didn't really matter whether you were in a squat or living with your parents or renting something. It wasn't important, because you were trying to do the thing that you were trying to do. And I guess I would have done it anyway, the things that I've done, whether I've been squatting or not. And maybe there's an argument to say that because I was able to have a studio in the basement, and I didn't have to pay for it, that maybe I wasted a lot of time down there, because I wasn't paying to rent the studio. So there isn't really that imperative to get the good stuff out. You can sort of be a bit more lazy about it. I mean, that might not be true, but it's possible that maybe a lot of time was wasted in squats, just hanging around, not really doing very much.
I'm tempted to say there's a bit too much modesty going on here. It's quite tempting to put forward the idea that these guys here are sort of aristocracy, a creative aristocracy. Well, they are. And that they're sort of squatting with a sort of Eton. And if Eton, you know, obviously male school, but it was a sort of Eton, that there's something going on, that particular kinds of people were engaged in squatting, doing work that became and remains important.
I think so much bad work was made in squats. I mean, like, I remember just being so envious of the people who had the squatted studio next to my flat in King's Cross, because they were just using it basically for storage, or they were just, you know, just dabbling for years at some, you know, kind of rubbish art making. That, I think, is the squat. Yeah. That was a huge part of the squat aesthetic, unfortunately. Yeah, of course, some things emerged from it, but I think there was a lot of wasted space, too.
Sometimes when I think about squatting, I think, what is comparable? I'm hitchhiking interests me. Hitchhiking hasn't been criminalized like squatting has. But people don't hitchhike anymore. When we were poorer and younger, I would hitchhike, and people don't hitchhike now. So there's something culturally different. It might be a safety thing, I'm not quite sure. But there are huge disjunctive changes I can't quite get a fix on, and I'd be very interested to hear what you have to say. I'll just do a bit of then and now, yeah, just kind of stream of consciousness. Then, poor quality but affordable housing. Now, no affordable housing. Then, poor rights, and in my opinion, an improvement now, theoretical, if only legislation, equality, improved, theoretical. So, in the olden days, little contemporary art, now huge amount of contemporary art. Then full grants, now no grants. Then music expensive, now music not expensive. Then students anarchic, now students career orientated. Any students here can disagree with that in the question and answer bit. Then radical 70s art and politics. Now I'm not quite sure what to say about that. Then sexual abuse of minors acceptable. Now not acceptable. What do you think?
Well, our band, the KLF, we didn't really have too many girl fans. It was mostly boys, so it's not really a problem for us. But I know that there was a kind of heavy metal tendency to veer towards younger girls in the 70s, but it doesn't really affect what we were doing.
Then, no porn. Now porn. Then homosexuality stigmatized. Now gay marriage. Then pubs. Now no pubs. Then alcohol, frighteningly expensive. Not that it ever stopped me. Now alcohol, very, very cheap. So is this adding anything to a sort of then and now understanding, or is it just a bit too random? Pete.
I don't know. I mean, for me, the whole situation was just a very sort of good support structure that maybe didn't really realize at the time. And in my experience, I left the UK in 86, I think, 87, and then I went to Montreal for 2 years. And as soon as I got to Montreal, I realized how good I had it here, because I'd somehow landed on my feet. I was living in, you know, squatted or housing association, paying next to nothing. I had a free studio, which kept going, and I don't know, there was a support structure here, and there were so many like-minded people as well. But then moving to to another situation in Canada, that kind of living just didn't exist, really, you know? You had to sort of get a job, you had to sort of
pay rent. If you wanted to have a studio, you had to rent that as well. And it just, I came back as soon as I could.
So was it a privileged time for us here? Was it a sort of golden
I think if you, as I say, if you landed on your feet and you met the right people and you sort of got an in into these situations, or you, then it was really, yeah.
It's pretty difficult for people now, isn't it, Ruth? You work with people studying. It's a very changed situation.
Well, I think
it?
It's very interesting that you mentioned the term support structure, infrastructure, but also community. And these two terms, we're always capable of recreating them somehow, the support structure and the community. So I don't think it's all bleak, and we can still somehow in this city, which is still, you know, this city is not finished, it's still evolving, we still can find these.
I mean, Pete, you are actually doing that now, aren't you, with your space in Murray Grove, aren't you?
Well, I'm kind of involved in a space, but it's not a squatted space. But we did do things in squatted spaces as well. So it's kind of just an extension of what one always did.
Is it part of community support?
No, it's not. It's just word of mouth, but I think that's the best way. It's not a very big space.
Ruud, what are you doing? You've got a space, haven't you?
Yeah, I also have a space near Pete's space. And it's an abandoned shop which we took from the council, and we are calling it a research organ, and artists and writers can do events there. So it is about an infrastructure, and one has to make it. And even the squat was an informal infrastructure, but it existed, and the people who were involved made the infrastructure happen. So I think it is that what one has to keep in mind.
I think then, like now, you had to be brave to make something happen. And for different reasons, you have to be brave in a different way now. I mean, then we had to be brave and carve a place out for ourselves and, you know, carve a home and be brave by kicking down doors and changing locks and being worried about the police or whoever coming and living on the streets and being attacked all the time or whatever. We had to be brave to sort of make a band and go against the music industry, go against housing, going against what was being prescribed for us as a role in society. And I think now you have to be brave in a different way, and that's sort of go against the sort of a conformism that's being, you know, placed upon young people, I'd say. People are so scared. People were scared then, people are scared now, and there's hopefully always a bunch of people who, you know, despite being scared often, which I was very shy, very scared person, feel the fear and do it anyway, to be a bit new age about it. But, you know, there have to be a certain amount of people. It used to be artists, you know, it used to be artistically minded people who did that. And artistically minded people now seem to be wanting to be entertainers and make money and be famous, or just to get some sort of adulation. And they don't seem a group in society who are sort of blazing the way and being brave and giving people a sort of counterculture.
Yes, but you have to remember that you were under the radar. It wasn't obvious. And I think these scenes are happening all around us now, and they're also under the radar. And maybe in 20 years' time, we will understand what was going on now, but it's not yet as obvious.
Yeah, I know young people who are squatting now in London, but only in industrial buildings, because it's only industrial buildings that you're allowed to squat in. So it's a very different type of squatting. They move en masse, they open a place up, but they get thrown out quite quickly. So they're kind of living out of a suitcase. It's not nothing like it used to be. There's no security, but there are people doing it. And
on a broader level, I mean, fuck squatting, really. I mean, what we need is people loudly, not under the radar, being seen. You know, punk was being seen by everybody within 18
months. But if you think
of
the hackers, for example, the hacker movement now, wouldn't that be an analogy, maybe?
Well,
of people sort of.
Yeah, I think activists and hackers are probably the most, you know, exciting and visible people. But of course, you need such skills. You can't blunder along. You know, if there was a way to be, you know, what we created was something that you didn't need skills to do. You just needed ideas and a bit of passion. Yeah, so I just feel that's sort of lacking, and it used to be the arts and music that led the way in that way.
I just wonder why young people stay in London, actually. Because, you know, the reason why, one of the reasons I came here, of course, was because of London first, and also friends who went to New York at the same time as I came here. We were there because it was cheap to be here as well. You could actually live here for next to nothing. It was just, it was a known fact. There was nothing actually that unusual about it, to be honest.
Yeah,
you got a bit luckier if you managed to get a squatted space or house. But you could actually live in London cheap anyway.
I'm a little puzzled as to why young people don't go to Margate, Bridgewater, Liverpool, where they have fantastic period buildings and rents are very cheap. But if there are any young people here, they can tell me what an idiot I am for even thinking about that in the question and answer moment. But yeah, there's lots of affordable housing outside of London. What there isn't in London is studio space anymore. Can I bring that up? Is there anything to be said about that? There is no studio space. There are good artists organized. There's word. Thank you. There is very little studio space in central London.
I think it's the same thing we just mentioned. It's like, why did people go to Berlin? I mean, people went en masse to Berlin, 10 years ago or so, because Berlin was exceptionally cheap and there's plenty of space.
There's an idea that the under-the-radar thing that people are doing now is the internet, and that the internet is equivalent to squatting, and that one day we'll look back and see the current internet or web, whatever it's called, thing. Sounds very great failure to put it like that. Sorry about that. That it's a Wild West. It's unregulated. When it is all monetized and when every second you're online is racking up a bill, we'll look back at this as a golden time, perhaps, on the web. What do you think?
Yeah, you might be right there, I think. I think in terms of music, actually, we're not really talking about music, but music and the internet, it's interesting how the internet helped to destroy the music business. And actually, I don't know why I'm even saying that, because it's got nothing to do with squatting, really, has it?
Well, it is to do with property. Squatting, a lot of it is to do with private or socialised, i.e. councils, ownership, and it's to do with property. So copyright, I think, is very relevant. There's ideas of property ownership, distribution of wealth. Music is a wealth, in my opinion. Was it distributed appropriately? In my opinion, no. I think it's very relevant to describe music as part of that, as part of an overall understanding of wealth, creative wealth. Total silence. Shall we move on to some other questions then? Okay. The Occupy movement, is that something that seems relevant, Ruth, do you think?
Sure, definitely. But where to start? I mean, that was in 2012 in London, and it seems like history. It seems like a long time gone, and what's left? That is the question. So, what can I say about Occupy? What has it left? Where can still get a hold on these ideas? It's kind of elusive for me. And maybe that's why the squatting, because it was so linked to creativity, it's more visible, it's more audible, it had more of a record as such. So maybe Occupy, being more in the political realm, didn't manifest itself in as much culturally and as such less, one can less get a hold of on it now. I mean, I can. Maybe it's different for everyone else.
It might sort of, it doesn't have so much presence now because everything's very quickly sort of packaged up and absorbed and moved on kind of thing, you know, in every way. and maybe what I was going back to what I was saying before about how slowly we did everything. You know, we had the space to do things slowly, and of course something had much more presence when it was done because of that. And that is one of the struggles of today, to be sort of seen and heard and sort of get above the sort of mass of culture, you know, sort of consumerism, and be seen above that, because it's very, whatever you do is very quickly taken, packaged and sold back at you, you know, or on a T-shirt or whatever. So that is one of today's problems. I wonder if, you know, I just think they're different problems, just different advantages as well. And yes, you know, to decentralise London and take art, you know, artists should be, you know, moving. We have the ability to work anywhere now, so, you know, why aren't they? Why are people saying, oh, no kids in London can afford a home? Well, yeah, go somewhere else then. You know, you've got to be the sort of person who can adapt and create within your circumstances. We did it in ours, and we would do it differently if we were young now. I would certainly be off to, you know, somewhere like Derby, have a place there, squat there, or, you know, low rent, and, you know, just decentralise. Good if London becomes less.
But I don't think you would go to Derby.
Maybe not Derby. I don't know.
Because I think one of the essential things is the community. And would you
find
online,
the community?
Yeah. But is that enough? Don't we need also the physical community?
Yeah, but there'll be all right people in Derby, I'm sure. It is, you know, so spread out now. You can feel your community. It's international.
I mean, what do you think about that, Pete? You've moved away from London, so your community is now...
Yeah, I mean, well, I moved back to somewhere I lived a long time ago. Yeah, and I think there's more possibilities there as far as, you know, space goes, that's for sure. Also for maybe starting things that have existed here for a long time and maybe have become a bit tired here, or maybe just a bit too known, I don't know. It's finding space. I mean, space is important, obviously, and I think you need time. As an artist, I'm sure for a musician too, you just need time to develop. And I think that, you know, the young artist who grows up here, who doesn't have wealthy parents or in New York, how do they find the time to actually develop their practice? And that's, if that's what you're interested in, that's the key, is to have time. So you have to try and find that space somewhere. I mean, I think, you know, without getting nostalgic, we were fortunate enough to sort of be here at a time when you could find that space here. But it's much more interesting to me, maybe, this discussion about talking to people who are here trying to do it now and what they do. Because I don't really know. Jimmy was talking about this industrial squatting. That all sounds really quite interesting, but I'd like to hear a bit more about that.
Some people would say the answer is philanthropy, wouldn't they? Some people in suits and ties would say that philanthropy would provide an opportunity. But that's directly opposite to the lawlessness thing we've been talking about.
That doesn't always make good art. It's like in, you know, in countries like Canada, they had, you know, pretty much every artist who graduated from art school would get a B grant, or if they're lucky, an A grant, and they'd be pretty much supported by the state. And then they had the art bank who bought work off all these people. But it didn't really do them much good, other than just having a life ticking along. It doesn't really sort of... So I think there's... You have to sort of... It has to come from yourself somehow.
Well, we're all horribly in agreement here, then. There's nothing left to talk about if we're all... Let's talk a bit about Smiler's work. Has everyone seen it? The show downstairs? The work is formally very beautiful. I didn't really notice that until Gareth cleaned up the negatives and presented them in the beautiful way that we see them downstairs. This is a unfortunate model for Smiler. If you look at her right hand, which is swollen from septicemia, from intravenous drug use, this, I think, is the... This is Dixon House in... Is it Mornington Crescent? Camden? Thank you.
Can we ask Smiler, though, how he chose the images out of all... the, whether there were many, many more, or...
Well, I didn't choose them. They were vacuum things across. It was the dark place, vigilantes, run by the Scots. But it was, squatting was a practical thing. And it was just sheer practicality. And the good thing about it is that people came together. Whether, by the way, I'd like to say that I'm never inhaled. So all sorts of different people came together in those gatherings, you know, whether it be working girls, pimps, small-time hoods, circus performers, wannabe painters and artists, wannabes like me, and, you know, it was a great mix, and it was a dark time. And Viv said, you know, it's not cool nowadays to moan about the changes of what's happening, you know, because if you look at the three people lately who've made the biggest kind of anti-establishment statements and the vilification that they've received, no wonder they crawled off into their holes.
Who are you talking about, Smart?
The new guy of Labour and that curly-haired comedian and the Welsh singer and the X Factor something or rather. And, you know, but they were slower days and more could happen. And I don't want to sound like a crusty old git, but housing now is a major political issue. And it's a pressure cooker, really. It's a pressure cooker. And, you know, we're getting street furniture now, which is anti-homeless street furniture. So it's become a part of architecture. To keep the homeless away from the pretty little atriums and foyers that are now guarded and have brass studs. So you know which... part of the pavement.
Root's image of that has just come up, a celebration of capitalist architecture with a little space in front of it. Sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt you, I just thought the photo was
you know,
up.
And I mean, I've got a boy of 25 and, you know, okay, some kids are okay, but I pity the, you know, it was a frightening time back in the 70s, but it's a pretty frightening time now as well. And there's not a lot of hope about for young people. Not a lot of hope about. Anyway, thank you for all coming to see.
Thank you, Smiley.
I think there wasn't a lot of hope for young people then either. I don't want to feel sorry for young people. You know, they have to break out of it, just like we did.
Shall we go on to the questions and answers bit of the evening? And I believe, is it okay with you, Smiler, if people can directly ask you questions as well, please? So we invite questions, preferably nice, short, simple, comprehensible ones. Thank you very much.
Hi, thank you for that. Thank you. The photographs are terrific. Thank you so much, Smiler. And the panel was great. I know this is like primarily about private space, public private space with housing, but I'm also really interested in public space of the time of the late 70s and into the early 80s. And we're partly in a cinema here, and I'd love to know if there are any cinemas that were particularly significant to you guys at the time.
It was definitely the Scala, all-nighters at the Scala. You know, if you had nowhere to go, you could sit there, and did sit there. We often sat there all night long.
They were brilliant. And the Gate.
And the Gate, yeah. We spent a lot of time in cinemas, actually.
People used to gather. People used to meet in cinemas. People would go to the Scala, the old Scala, not the one King's Cross, just to go to the bar, because the bar was open late. And actually the bar here, too, was open late. Yeah.
There were many more socialised spaces than there are now. Pubs were a neutral social space. Cinemas.
They weren't neutral for women, pubs, back then.
Thank you, Viv.
Yeah, we used to rehearse in the Ritzy in Brixton before it was turned back into a cinema in kind of mid to late 70s.
The cinema was very interesting in the 70s, of course, as well. You know, there were very interesting things being done in cinema, all the new directors, auteur-type directors. So it seemed like things were moving, to me, more interestingly along that route than they were almost musically, actually.
Yeah, because there was a big difference between mainstream cinema and what the kind of repertory cinema showed. And I suppose the same could be said for mainstream theatre and what the kind of the off-theatre show presented.
Any more questions?
Choose to squat, and when did you stop, and why?
Me?
No.
It was
did
a choice
to
do it. I could have got a job and rented something if I chose to do that.
Yeah.
I wanted that kind of lifestyle, but then I had to stop squatting in the end because the group that I was in was having number one hits all over the world, and I would have to go to the co-op meeting and explain why I'd been using the co-op van to go to Top of the Pops, and it just became untenable in the end. I had to I was lucky enough to be able to buy a house, but I kind of got out of it in about 1991.
I'm just to say it was very different for girls back then, because, you know, people think of the 70s as being very cool, all orange and brown, wavy curtains and sort of things, you know, white plastic furniture, but actually the morally it was like the 50s really for women then. And so my choice, as far as I knew it, was to be a primary school teacher, or maybe I could be a policewoman, because I saw this thing called Z cars, and the only place I saw young women working was there. You know, I had no role models, not even been to a hospital and seen a nurse. So for young women, it was kind of like the 40s. You didn't really move out of your home until you got married. You saved up with your fiancé, and so there was no way I was going down that route, because it didn't interest me. It wasn't even in front of me as a nice option. I didn't know any lawyers, or there were no female architects, you know, at the time. I mean, none of those things were in front of me. So as far as I was concerned, I had an alternative life or really nothing, you know. So this wasn't much of a choice, but it was pretty plain to me that either I trained to be a primary school teacher or a policewoman, or and got married and did that, or I just busted out.
In the 70s, tens of thousands of buildings were empty in London. They were owned by councils and the GLC. They were allowed to remain empty for literally decades and to be run down. And so it's a bit like being a very hungry person. If you're a hungry person, you have some money, you might be able to go out and buy some food. But if there's this super abundant, huge pile of food in front of you, why not eat it? It's there and it's going to waste. That's the way I look at it. The councils were idiots, neglectful, irresponsible, stupid, wasteful. It's difficult to say how foolish they were and how they underused this resource that belonged to everybody. Any other question at the very back? Could you have a microphone or speak up?
You've not talked about boating and the boating community that is emerging in London, and how there is a huge transference of both professionals and people seeking an alternative lifestyle that's not supported in the same way that squatting was due to the availability of buildings. But there is a very much a thriving and growing boating community in London, people that live in the canals. How do you feel about that?
You said boating. Yes. Does anyone want to talk about boating?
I don't know.
I do know a bit about boating, but I prefer to hear other people's opinion. Boating has become quite regularized as to become not really, in my opinion, a separate category. It's in terms of the housing problem we have, it's not really any different, in my opinion. What is different are people, as I recently saw in Scotland, who've gone and built communities in the hills without any planning permission, over 70 buildings. That's a little bit different, and I'm aware of people create using their creative imagination to live like that, but that's generally outside the urban areas. Thank you for your question. Would you like to ask a question?
Can I have a last one? Is that cool?
This gentleman was first, and then we'll go to you. We'd like to ask your question.
Thank you, Smiler, for mentioning my brother. Hello. Is it? Oh, yes. Okay. What I wanted to ask was, first of all, could I just point out, today is the 40th anniversary of when 200 people were rehoused from the barricade in Elgin Avenue, London, West 9, today. And tomorrow, you should applaud that. Happy birthday to me and the 200 others. 40th birthday, I mean. We're going to have a big meeting over in West London tomorrow about the past and the present and how all the stuff happening then, a lot of it is actually being carried on now, and I want to ask you guys, obviously, if you're going to be able to come. And it's going to be in the Arts Paddington place, Paddington Arts Centre, 32 Woodfield Road at 7 p.m, which is Westbourne Park Tube. And it's quite a big meeting space. We're going to have banners and stuff there and information. And I just want to sort of comment on, you know, then and now, but because if this meeting was organised in a squat, it wouldn't be arranged like this. We'd have this stuff in a ring, you know, and people would all be talking in a participatory manner, which I hope we are, in fact, about to do, or a more participatory manner. But I wanted to ask a specific sort of question about then and now, because to me then, you know, how we got to barricades and how we got rehousing and all that was really the squats there. There were two sort of things going on. One is that we had communities of struggles, and the other thing is we had theatres of possibilities. And they were mixed up completely. You know, we had The Clash, we had poster workshops, we had people's cafes, we had street meetings, we had street people's courts, we had a squatters' pirate radio, and so on. And we had dichotomies between squatters and tenants. But now, squatters and occupiers and tenants work totally, totally together in you know, Aylesbury Estate, Alton Estate, East End, E15, people up in Hendon, and so on. We'll hear from those tomorrow. Sorry, I'm rambling a bit. But the point is that I think a lot of the things happened then have just been co-opted. You see, we used to have the Electric Cinema Club in Notting Hill, I remember, but now, you see, these type of radical cinemas have become like, well, you can pay to go into them, you know, whereas then it was kind of radical and fun. So radical and funness has been, you know, co-opted and turned into business. So I better stop there, but I just want to know, well, one, will you come? Two, will everyone else here come? And three, I'll repeat it, 7 o'clock, 32 Woodfield Road, Westbourne Park, to tomorrow. Thank you,
Piers. Thank you very much. Can I say, I thought the anniversary was tomorrow, Piers. No. I was going to mention it, but today, it is today. Thank you very much. Okay, I thought it was tomorrow.
It's true about the Electric Cinema, though, yeah. But there's a pop-up cinema underneath the Westway. Run by Tim Burke, who, you know, who, yeah, so it sort of moves around. We needn't give up, and yeah, good on your brother for.
And thank you, Piers, for all your work in those days, keeping things together. I know people's hearts used to drop when you came round to our squats. Piers, in honour of those days, I thought I'd just read out a number of the squatting areas that I am familiar with, I'm sure Piers is, as a sort of quick honouring. There are lots of other ones. Anyone can drop in anything they want. I'll just mention them. Frestonia, Stoney Street, Bristol Gardens, Elgin Avenue, Chippenham Road, Monmouth Road, Orsett Terrace, which is Viv, Old Schoolhouse, King's Cross, Cromer Street, which is Pete, Bonington Square, fantastic, remaining, enjoys continuity of a kind that's unusual in London because of the squatters. Tolmer's Square, Sasha Craddock, the art writer, was involved in that. She's written very interestingly on squatting. Huntley Street and Daventry Street. Again, that's you, Viv, isn't it?
Oh, yeah. So I've got Daventry Street, where Boogie, a photographer, Raincoats, the Slits rehearsed, Orsett Terrace, where the Flowers of Romance, mine and Sid Vesh's band rehearsed, Joe Strummer, the 101ers, Lonsdale Square, where the Slits rehearsed, and more on the fanzine, the first fanzine created by women, started. Davis Road, where the Clash formed, my squat, where the Clash formed, Paul Simonon lived there. Lillishaw Road, which was started out a squat, but the council gave them keys. Elgin Avenue, where I first heard Chrissie Hynde sing with an acoustic guitar. And Barry Black's, who ran the Roxy Club squat in Elgin Crescent as well.
Fantastic, Viv, thank you. We don't know much about South London.
I know South London.
I'm really sorry about that. If anyone here does, they're very... Yes. Yeah. In. Exactly. Yes. If I may boast here, I wrote the sleeve notes for that album. So thank you very much for that. In my housing co-op, we squatted, and then we started a co-op, and there's an interesting letter. I was going through the old archives the other day, and there's a letter asking someone to stay in their flat while they're on holiday. It's Joe Strummer. So the letter said, please may I ask that my friend Joe Strummer stay in my flat while I'm on holiday. Just compare that with the squatting hammer kicking door, and then people are writing polite letters asking if people can stay in their flat for the holidays. Other questions?
Can I get one?
Yes,
I grew up, like, weirdly, coincidentally, I didn't come for this talk, but I grew up on the edge of Somerstown at King's Cross, and I was just really intrigued as someone who was probably going to infant school when you were around there, whoever was living around there, and I'm just really interested to know, did you have any interaction with the people that were from there, from Somerstown or King's Cross or around the area, or did they perceive you as like a weird bunch of people who'd come into the area to do something, or did you hang out with them?
Well, I live in Somerstown as well, in Osselton Street,
yeah.
And that's when the whole courtyard was just full of all the travellers. The travellers took over. I don't know if you were around then, if you're that young.
I always had that sort of weird, vivid thing. I went to school with kids whose like parents were into that and they weren't as squatters' rights, but I also went to school with kids whose parents weren't into that, and completely different. And I'm just interested if you hung out with those people that lived where you were doing this. Or if people that you lived with were from there?
Well,
from London.
I mean, of course there was interaction, but because you went to the same shops, pubs.
Yeah, but they wouldn't...
Bought from the same dealers.
Did they come in the squat and hang out and party with
No,
you?
Not really.
No.
Not really. Like, I mean, now Smiler, but I can't really remember that so much.
You're from London, right? Or you're not? So none of you are actually from London?
I shagged a bloke from around there once. I shagged a bloke.
We've moved around a lot. I don't think we're giving him satisfaction. We did move around a lot. We all know each other because we shagged each other and we bought drugs from dealers.
Just like if anyone who was in that scene actually came from those areas. Like
Tolmer Square, was that around there? Because I hung out with those people. That was a couple of roads away.
They were like actually people who came from that area. They'd hang out with you, like party with you or whatever. Or it was just like a bunch of people who moved in.
No, it very much all mixed up, very much. It was a very mixed scene, you know, and, you know, especially my bit wasn't at all middle class, you know, the kids I hung out with.
I'm just saying that we did cross completely.
But actually, back then, it sort of wasn't asked. I mean, I went to school in North London, hung out with kids from, you know, I mean, some were sort of a bit more, there's Barney Boatman, the Boatman family, one of them was standing for the King's Cross area, and then there was the Tolmouth Square boys and girls who, you know, squatted all that whole area. We all mixed and we all went to each other's things, and it sort of, I don't remember being conscious about, you know, where you were from, really. Yeah, no, I don't think there was awareness, really, at all. I mean, amazingly, we hardly asked each other any questions as well.
Are you talking about local people as well?
Yeah.
I literally grew up around the corner from them, and obviously I was really, like, you know, 3, 4, whatever at the time you're talking about. And I'm just interested to see if the people around there were receptive to what you were doing, i.e.
Well, there are actually a lot of children, you know, there are a lot of children who live in the squats too, or in the housing association, and they all went to the local schools.
Yeah.
So there was that, of course there was interaction, yeah.
Local people, found were quite divided. They'd often be frightened when squatters appeared, but often, as in the flower picture that I have up here, when they saw the flowers, they were very happy. Yeah. So local people were very interested. Younger ones would like the vibrancy and the creativity of the squatters.
And King's Cross was very rough then. I mean, really scary, yeah.
When the squatters built the adventure playground, that was a really good connection in terms of, like...
Meanwhile Gardens.
Bemerton Street, you know, where the old tenements were. And that's when the community came together. They certainly didn't get together in the pubs. They certainly were seen as very different. And the people that were down in King's Cross area that were working at Peace News, they were very, very involved trying to build a new community, because when all the slums were pulled down, basically the community was destroyed. Yeah. In that part of the Cali, you know, the south part of the Cali, which is being so-called regenerated. But, yeah, that's another argument.
Thank you.
But those tenements were basically completely empty, like Neil was saying, you know. Well, I wouldn't know if you could put it like that, but I know what you're saying. And there was vigilantes at work in Somerstown at one point as well, I remember. And later on, when I brought up my son, I found out how, you know, what it was like for local people and especially kids. And, you know, you open your front door in the morning and, you know, there's someone just on the floor and smoking crack and just leaving all the paraphernalia around in front. And my kid was terrified. He was terrified. So I saw it from both sides.
Yeah. I mean, my question was aimed at being a town
council
grow up to
the tree. Thank you. We're running out of time. I'd like to invite other people to ask any questions they feel are important for them, either to
just
the panel here or to Smiler.
Just time for one last question.
One last question. Yeah. Better be a good one. Maybe from a female. Good question. Is that Jane England there? Yeah. Hi, Jane. Do you want to ask a question?
Well, it's more a comment, really. I mean, I never squatted in the 70s, but I knew a lot of people that did, and I also took photographs of people that were squatting. But I think it doesn't seem tonight that anything's come out about the kind of... A lot of the people I knew that were squatting were really having a great time, and it was quite celebratory. They were sort of... had taken over houses, wonderful Georgian houses, and people were making things, having parties, having a fantastic time. I mean, it was... quite wonderful. It wasn't always a kind of negative thing. And I think it was a very creative scene in some aspects. Some people obviously were having a tough time, but other young people were coming and were really making the most of it.
I think
that hasn't quite come across.
When I talked about sex and drugs and depravity, I wasn't necessarily talking negatively. So that was our last... Thank you very much, Jane. Thank you. I think that formally brings us to the end, then. Thank you very, very much. Thank you. Thank you, audience. Thank you, Smiler. Thank you very much for the lovely photograph, Smiler.